Hello friends and welcome back to the channel. Meta has just released their new language model. In this video, I'm going to be analyzing its limitations, pros, cons, and many other things that we need to know to decide whether it fits our use cases. So to begin with, we can see that they increased the context window to 4,000 tokens, but when you start passing extra information about your brand, about what you want to write or the writing styles you want to add to the prompt, then 4,000 tokens is quite short. If you compare it to GPT, which can do 32,000 tokens, or Claude, which can do up to 100,000 tokens, then 4,000 tokens is quite small. So that's gonna be a thumbs down. The training data was mostly on English, which makes this model not suitable for other languages based on what the paper says. We can see here the percentages of languages that were used, and it was mainly English. Now, something I saw and I was quite happy to see was that Meta put a lot of emphasis on Dreadfulness, which means that this model should generate reliable outputs that agree with factuality or common sense. And this is nice because a lot of other models have a lot of problems with hallucination or making up facts. And having this kind of like in the DNA of the model is nice. They have also tried to make this model as safe as possible. And this means that in certain categories or topics, the model is not going to help you. But they also included unqualified advice, so medical advice, financial advice, and legal advice. If you are in a niche where it's your money or your life, this model is not going to help you. Another area in which it won't help you is with humor, especially if the humor you want to generate is going to be one of those topics that Meta finds offensive or problematic. I believe it will still do humor if you ask on certain topics that are just fine or more politically correct, but for more spicy sort of humor, it's not going to generate anything. And lastly, Llama won't be able to help you with code. It's pretty bad, the benchmarks we are getting from Llama 2, especially compared to GPT-3 or GPT-4. Llama is just not going to be a good coder, let's say. I wonder if this is because of making Llama 2 super reliable in terms of like factual output. As long as you are asking for the actual facts, kind of like in a straight way, that's gonna be good. But if you are asking Llama 2 to kind of like combine different facts that it knows about, that might be a challenge for Llama 2. In terms of knowledge cutoff, it's much better than other models that we have seen. So this model in particular has a cutoff of September 2022. And on top of the actual training, some tuning data as well was used to train this model. And it can go up to July 2023, which is pretty much now. It's not going to keep up with new information, but at least it's very close to the present date. When we look at this model, it doesn't look especially powerful compared to the other options we have available as of now. What I think Meta did here was to minimize the liability they could be accounted for. But I think Meta did a great job in terms of like laying the foundations for other people to come take this model and keep training it with other type of data. Because when you look at how much time it took to train this model, 3.3 million GPU hours, it's a lot of computing power in terms of millions of dollars. And this is something only organizations with great funding can do. So the fact that they decided to train this model and give it open source for anyone to take it and have the chance to fine-tune this model into other areas. Because when you look at GPT or Claude, they are nice models, but they are closed. So this close the doors to many other organizations or many other teams to come in and train their own models, while Llama2 is very extendable. And so even if today we don't have the perfect model with Llama2, I think this is going to open the doors to many other people to come and start training their own models, very specialized on certain niches, and do it in a very efficient way, because they are already saving so much time in training the base model. So that's it for today, guys. I don't think I will be using this model because of the many limitations it comes with, but it's always really nice to see that there is something that might lead to an explosion of new open source models. So it's going to be really nice to see how this unravels in the next few months. I hope you find my analysis useful and straight to the point. If you like this video and you want to support my work, please like, share, and subscribe. I post a new video every week, so see you next week.